We have already covered microsporogenesis, megasporogenesis, and pollination, which means that our pollen has landed on the stigma and the compatibility issues have also been resolved. So now what next? The next step is fertilization and post-fertilization events, and that is our learning goal for today. If compatible, pollen lands on the stigma, fertilization will occur, leading to embryogenesis and fruit and seed formation. So these are our learning goals for today. You remember the structure of pollen? It has a germ pore and two nuclei on the inside, the vegetative and the generative. This is when pollen is shed at two cell stage. Sometimes it is also shed at three cell stage. If it is shed at three cell stage, it already has two male gametes. Fertilization involves landing of compatible pollen on correct stigma. Once the pollen is accepted by the stigma, few events happen simultaneously, the first of which is that pollen tube is formed. Pollen tube comes out of the germ pore of this pollen and two male gametes are formed. As pollen tube moves through the tissue of style and reaches ovary, the content of pollen along with the two male gametes comes into the pollen tube. And this growing pollen tube reaches the micropyle in the ovary. You can see the pollen tube reaching the micropyle. The two male gametes in the pollen are released into the ovule. You recall that the micropylar end has the egg apparatus with the egg cell or the female gamete and the two synergids. So the male gamete are released in the cytoplasm of one of the synergids. Then one of these male gametes fuses with the egg cell to form the zygote. This is known as syngamy. Besides the egg apparatus, you remember there are these two polar nuclei in the center of the ovule. So the second male gamete moves towards these polar nuclei, fuses with these two polar nuclei to form primary endosperm nucleus or PEN, PEN. Now here three nuclei are fusing, the two polar and the male gamete. So this is known as triple fusion. Can you tell the ploidy level of this primary endosperm nucleus? One set of chromosome from the male gamete, one from one of the polar nuclei and one from the second polar nuclei. So it has three sets of chromosome. This central cell with the primary endosperm nucleus is now known as primary endosperm cell. It is triploid and it will form the endosperm later. This endosperm will provide nutrition to the developing embryo. Where does the embryo come from? From the zygote. Now, what would be the ploidy level of zygote? You can take a look. Okay, so finally the most important thing. Here you can see that the fertilization event comprises of two episodes. The first one is syngamy or the fertilization of male gamete with the egg cell. And the second one is triple fusion or the fertilization of the second male gamete with the two polar nuclei. So there is simultaneous occurrence of two different events during fertilization. So this type of fertilization is known as double fertilization. This is a unique feature of sexual reproduction in flowering plants or sexual reproduction in the angiosperms. After double fertilization, the post-fertilization events begin. Here, ovule will gradually develop into the seed and the ovary will form the fruits. But first the embryo sac. What happens to the other cells in the embryo sac? Start from synergids. Synergids degenerate. Zygote and central cell you already know. And then the antipodals. They also degenerate. Two developments have to happen: zygote to embryo and primary endosperm nucleus to endosperm. Which of these will occur first? I'll explain this with a very simple example. If your school gets over at 2 p.m., does your mom wait for you to reach home and then starts making lunch for you? Or she prepares food before you are home? Of course, she's ready with the lunch by the time you reach home. So using this logic, which would start first? Embryo development or endosperm development? Of course, endosperm development precedes embryo development. Now let's see how endosperm develops. The primary endosperm cell divides continuously and repeatedly. But here also, there are options. First option, cell will divide. That is, both nucleus division and cytoplasm division will occur. Or the second option, only the nucleus will divide, that is free nuclear division. This is the most common type of endosperm. And then there is the third option where a combination of above two occur. Have you seen a coconut? In coconut, the water is the free nuclear endosperm and the white part is the cellular endosperm. Last thing about the endosperm. In some seeds, endosperm is completely consumed during embryo development, and such seeds are known as exalbuminous seed. Example, pea, groundnut, and beans. In others, it remains in a mature seed. Some of the endosperm remains even after the embryo has matured. It is then used for seed germination, and such seeds are known as albuminous seeds. Example, castor, coconut, wheat, and maize. Sometimes even nucellus from ovule remains in seeds. Such a persistent nucellus is known as perisperm. Example, black pepper and beet. We come to embryogenesis, or the development of embryo. It occurs at the micropylar end. It begins after some amount of endosperm is already formed. This is to ensure that seed formation is not interrupted due to lack of nutrition for the developing embryo. Though early stages of development of embryo are same in monocots and dicots, differences arise at a later stage. Initially, embryo in both of these undergo a series of stages, and this is how the development of these stages occurs. Now, the development of dicot embryo. The dicot embryo comprises of two parts, the embryonal axis and the cotyledons. There are two cotyledons in dicot embryo. The embryonal axis again has two parts. The part above the cotyledons is known as epicotyle, and this will develop into plumule. The plumule forms the shoot system. The part below the epicotyle is known as hypocotyle. It develops into radical, or the root system, which has a root cap at its tip to protect the radical from abrasion or destruction due to microorganisms in the soil. The monocot embryo has the embryonal axis, and there is only one cotyledon, that is the scutellum. Scutellum is present on the lateral side of the shoot apex, or the coleoptile. The coleoptile comprises of shoot apex and some leaf primordia. Then there is the portion below the cotyledons, or the hypocotyle, which has coleorrhiza. The coleorrhiza has root or radical, which will later form root and the root cap. Now the seed. This is the final product of sexual reproduction and has all the key players required for development of progeny. The seed has three main parts: the seed coat, cotyledons, and the embryonal axis. The seed coat is tough, made by hardening of the integuments present in the ovule, and it has a micropyle. The cotyledons are thick and swollen. They store food reserve. The embryonal axis comprises of the plumule and the radicle. Now let's see the functions of each of these. The seed coat protects the seed. It has a micropyle which allows oxygen for respiration and water for germination. The cotyledons provide nutrition, and the embryonal axis forms the new plant. The plumule gives rise to the shoot system, and the radicle gives rise to the root system. As seed begins to germinate, it loses its water till almost 10 to 15% of water remains, which means it becomes very dry. Its metabolic rate reduces and it enters an inactive stage. This stage is known as seed dormancy. Once the favorable conditions return, that is water, oxygen, and suitable temperature are available, the seed will break its dormancy and begin to germinate. Now, seed formation is very advantageous to angiosperm. Why? Let's find out. Water is not needed for pollination or fertilization, so seed formation is not dependent on water. Now, angiosperms can reproduce and thrive in areas with lesser water. Seeds are adapted for dispersal. They can be transferred to far-off areas and germinate away from the parent plant. Thus, they help in spread of plant. They have sufficient food reserves to take care of the emerging seedlings till the time photosynthesis begins. The hard seed coat protects them from adverse climate. And finally, the most important part, they are capable of producing new genetic combinations in the new plant. So seeds can remain viable for longer periods. Some remain viable for a few months and some for hundreds of years. Some extreme cases are Lupinus arcticus, which is found in Arctic area. It was known to germinate after 10,000 years of dormancy. Then a 2,000-year-old seed of date palm or Phoenix dactylifera was found near Dead Sea and it germinated. Seeds are also important for us because they are the basis of our agriculture. On that note, let's take a break. We'll continue again. Here are your questions for practice. Good luck. Bye-bye.